आ गए हैं. थैंक यू. वेट फॉर फ्यू सेकेंड्स फॉर अदर्स टू ज्वाइन. गुड मॉर्निंग मंजरी जी. गुड मॉर्निंग प्रवीण सर. गुड मॉर्निंग सोनाली जी. सो वी हैव फोर पार्टिसिपेंट्स राइट नाउ इंक्लूडिंग आवर कन्वीनर डॉक्टर सोमू सिंह जी. Let's wait for a few more minutes, few more seconds for others to join in. And this would be my first experience going live or talking about inclusive education on Facebook page. So in a way it is like ki aapse seedhe seedhe बात हो रही है पर मैं बोल रही हूँ और आप लिख करके बात कर रहे हैं. सो इन अ वे इट्स गुड फॉर आवर टुडेज टॉपिक. ओके सो नाउ अराउंड 27-28 पार्टिसिपेंट्स आर देयर. सो आई बिलीव वी कैन स्टार्ट दिस टॉपिक. माई सेल्फ डॉक्टर भारती. आई वर्क एज एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर इन द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एजुकेशन ऑफ ग्रुप्स विद स्पेशल नीड्स इन NCERT, न्यू दिल्ली. एंड टुडे आर टॉपिक इज इंक्लूसिव एजुकेशन. इंक्लूसिव एजुकेशन देर आर वेरियस आस्पेक्ट्स. इट्स अ वास्ट टॉपिक. सो टुडे द मेजर थीम्स दैट वुड बी कवर्ड वुड बी वॉट इज इंक्लूजन. लेट्स अंडरस्टैंड अबाउट इंक्लूजन. वॉट इंक्लूजन इज एंड वॉट इंक्लूजन इज नॉट. What are the principles of inclusion? Who are the beneficiaries of inclusion? And the journey from exclusion to inclusion. And we will end this talk by talking about, or this knowing a little more about, United Nations Convention on Right to Persons with Disability. So the very first thing is to know about inclusion. And as we all are aware, stories always inspire us, they charm us. And how to begin this talk on inclusive education, what better way could be than the story? So let me begin it with a story from one of our ancient, you can say, literature or mythology. You have heard about all the stories, how they start. Almost all the stories starts with once upon a time. So our story today is also going to start with once upon a time. There was a kingdom ruled by a noble, kind king who was very benevolent, who takes care of all the persons living in his kingdom. He was very kind. He didn't have any extra taxes on the praja. So everybody was happy in his kingdom except the king. Now, why the king was not happy? King had three sons, and all his sons he had sent to various Gurukuls. Gurukuls were like schools we have in today's day or today's era. So all the sons were sent to the Gurukul. Now, the king has exhausted the list of Gurukuls and gurus who were running these schools. But these prince or his sons, they were not able to learn anything in the Gurukul. And every guru has said, no, we can't teach your sons. They are beyond us. They are beyond our ways and methods of teaching. So the everybody in the kingdom was happy except the king. So now his ministers, they came to know about this worry of the king or anxiety of the king. And one of the very wise counsel in his council of ministers, he advised king, why don't you inform everybody in the kingdom that whosoever will be able to teach all the three things, he will be given a very good reward. तो अब जैसे कि पुराने जमाने में होता था, सोशल मीडिया तो इस तरह से नहीं होता था, तो पूरे राज्य भर में मुनादी पिटवा दी गई. एवरीबडी वॉज टोल्ड कि हु एवर विल बी एबल टू टीच द थ्री प्रिंस ही विल बी गिवन गुड रिवॉर्ड. सो देर वॉज अ वेरी वाइज पंडित लिविंग इन द किंगडम कॉल्ड विष्णु शर्मा. विष्णु शर्मा जी ने जब ये सुना तो ही सेड, आई टेक इट एज अ चैलेंज बट आई विल नॉट एक्सेप्ट द रिवॉर्ड इफ आई विल बी सक्सेसफुल. एंड ही वॉज इन्वाइटेड टू द पैलेस टू टीच द किंग सन. एंड ही सेड ओके, आई एक्सेप्ट इट एज अ चैलेंज एंड आई शुड बी एबल टू फिनिश इट विद इन 6 months, बट आई नीड अ फ्री हैंड. नो बडी इज गोइंग टू क्वेश्चन वॉट हाउ वाई वेयर आई एम डूइंग दिस. यू विल ऑल योर क्वेश्चन विल बी आंसर्ड ओनली आफ्टर 6 months. सो दिस इज हाउ द एजुकेशन ऑफ द थ्री सन्स बिगन. नाउ वॉट विष्णु शर्मा डिड वॉज ही स्पेंड सम टाइम विद द थ्री बॉयज एंड केम टू नो दैट द बॉयज लाइक द लॉट अबाउट एनिमल्स एंड देव आर द नेचर लवर्स. सो ही वॉट एवर ही वॉन्टेड टू टीच टू दीज बॉयज, ही फ्रेम्ड एंड मैप्ड देम इन टू द एनिमल स्टोरीज एंड फेबल्स एंड ही टोल्ड देम, ही टॉट देम अबाउट हु आर आर गुड फ्रेंड्स, हाउ टू जज वेदर अ पर्सन इज अ गुड फ्रेंड और नॉट अ गुड फ्रेंड, हाउ टू सेव वन सेल्फ फ्रॉम लॉस ऑफ मटीरियल गुड्स एंड हाउ टू प्रोटेक्ट वन सेल्फ फ्रॉम द एनिमीज. दिस इज हाउ ही फ्रेम द करिकुलम एंड डिवाइडेड इन टू 5 स्ट्रैंड्स. नाउ वेन आई से 5 स्ट्रैंड्स, यू माइट बी थिंकिंग ऑफ पंचतंत्र. येस फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज हाउ द एजुकेशन ऑफ द किंग्स सन वॉज डन बाय पंडित विष्णु शर्मा जी थ्रू एनिमल फेबल्स. एंड दीज एनिमल फेबल्स आई बिलीव इज द फर्स्ट ट्रीटी ऑन इंक्लूसिव एजुकेशन वेयर इन करिकुलम वॉज डिवाइज एज पर द नीड ऑफ द स्टूडेंट्स. एंड स्टूडेंट्स हियर वर थ्री किंग, थ्री प्रिंस, द सन ऑफ द किंग. सो वॉट पंडित विष्णु शर्मा जी डिड वॉज ही डिवाइज द करिकुलम इन 5 स्ट्रैंड्स एज पर द नीड ऑफ द दैट टाइम king and the sons. And then not only this, he also molded the teaching learning methods so that the three boys were able to understand what he is trying to teach them. This is how he became successful. And this panchatantra, if you look very carefully, this is, I can say, the mantra of inclusive education is within this methodology, pedagogy adopted by Pandit Vishnu Sharma to teach these three boys. Now, this is one extreme of our ancient India. Another extreme, we have Karna. Remember Karna from Mahabharata? Now, he was known as Radhe and not as the son of Kunti, Queen Kunti, the mother of all the five noble Pandavas. Karna was not known as Pandava, so he was denied admission to the Gurukul of Parshuramji, where he wanted to learn all the Shastra Vidya. Now, why he was denied admission and teaching learning in this Gurukul, which was run by Rishi Parshuramji? Just because he belongs to a particular community and he didn't belong to a particular other community which was accepted in his Gurukul. So this is a glaring example of exclusion from the education system, and this is a very famous example. And another famous example is of Eklavya. Remember Eklavya? He approached Guru Drona to learn archery, and Guru Drona refused teaching Eklavya on the pretext that he was teaching again the Kuru Rajkumars, the Pandavas and the Kauravas. So he said he is not allowed to teach any local person. This was a polite way of refusing, but Eklavya being Eklavya, he didn't left so easily, he didn't give up so easily. So he started practicing on his own. And when Drona and Arjun came to know about it, so Eklavya had to do away with his thumb. from which he was able to do archery. So again, the treatment given to this student by the guru and the other student in the Gurukul is another glaring example how the marginalized, how the disadvantaged section of the society is treated, and they were made to feel not welcome in the education system. Now, in the lecture on inclusive education, these are the three examples where in the very first was where Pandit Vishnu Sharma ji modified the curriculum pedagogy to teach the way students wanted to learn and they were able to learn. And the rest two examples are the students wanted to learn but they were made to feel unwelcome. Now, coming back to our present day context, what and how we are seeing exclusion from our modern day education system. You remember, or you must be familiar, that in your city and wherever you are living, there are high end public schools, private schools run by private organizations. They might be affiliated, they may not be affiliated. They may be associated to your state boards or the CBSE board or the national board or any other ICSSR board or something. But how many parents who may not be affluent, they are able to send their children to these high-end schools? The answer is depending on their economic status and condition. So economic status in today's world, in today's era, is a yardstick of exclusion. This might be an indicator of exclusion, how children are excluded from our so-called high-end quality schools, which are running completely in AC environment and claim to be international and imparting values, experience in learning and so on. So this is today's reality. Now, when we are talking about inclusive education and trying to contextualize it, let's see what inclusion is not. Now you'll say, why I'm starting with what inclusion is not? You know, I started with the ancient Indian mythology and Panchatantra. और हमारे वेदों में तो कहा भी है कि जब आप ईश्वर की बात करते हो तो आप क्या कहते हो कि ईश्वर ये नहीं है, ये नहीं है, नहीं नेति प्रिंसिपल का आप इस्तेमाल करते हो ना, तो वहीं से हम शुरू करते हैं कि चलिए पहले शुरू करते हैं इंक्लूसिव एजुकेशन क्या नहीं है, वॉट इंक्लूसिव एजुकेशन इज नॉट. So the very first thing is inclusive education is not a first time, one time activity that is like we have done it for one time and now we are done with it. It's not like you went to the class, you delivered a lecture like this one and you are done with the entire topic. No, inclusive education is not a one time activity. It is not static and it is not about bringing children with disabilities at par with children without disabilities. It's not like an attempt on the part of the teacher or the school administrators that okay, yes, now you are well, you have we have taken you into our school, now we will try to normalize you, we'll try to make your abilities at par with other students, even if not better. So this is not at all inclusion. Then inclusion is not about in my regular school, I'm the principal, I'm the teacher, I'm the head teacher, I'm the supervisor. So I have created this particular corner or space for you to sit and study with or without interaction with your peers. So inclusion is also not this practice of creating a dedicated space for children with disabilities in the regular schooling system. And inclusive education is not about asking the learner to change. Yes, when I'm saying learner, it's I'm talking about children with disabilities. It's not about ki aap mere school ki practices ke hisab se khud ko change karoge. If my school starts at 8 o'clock and I have classes allocated for third standard at second floor and you are a child who is using a wheelchair, So I'm not going to shift the classes from second floor to the ground floor because you are using wheelchair. You have to adjust to my school's policy and practices. This attitude is not at all inclusive. So this practice is also not at all inclusive practices or inclusive education practice. Another thing is, in inclusive education, we cannot be rigid. So inclusion is not about rigidity. Inclusion is not about expecting learners to change. Inclusion is not about creating dedicated spaces. And inclusion is also not about merely physically allowing children to sit and study. Now, you will be confused right now. Should be, if you are not, that once the children with disabilities are sitting in the classroom, we are making them sit, share space with the children without disabilities, then how come this is not inclusion? Friends, this is not inclusion. This might be only one superficial dimension of inclusion, which we call physical inclusion. Physically, you and I have included these children in our classrooms, but they are not encouraged to participate in the classroom. Hence, this may not be inclusion in the true sense. Okay, so we have understood what inclusion is not. So let's define what inclusion is. If I'm saying that this is not inclusion, this is not inclusion, this is not inclusion, so what is inclusion? Inclusion is basically allowing all children to sit together, study together, maybe from the same curriculum, using the same pedagogical processes, and with the help of lot of support services in the form of special educators, in the form of counselors, in the form of available therapies, in the form of adaptations and modifications in the curriculum. We may design some specific teaching learning material for enhancing the participation of all children in the classroom activity. So inclusion is welcoming all, accepting all, and seeing value in each and every individual, irrespective of the differences arising due to their individual abilities, disabilities, talents, strengths, weaknesses, belonging to a particular community and coming from a particular region, following a particular religion, their socioeconomic status in the society, all these differences. With all these differences, acceptance and valuing the learner is inclusive education. And inclusive education connects and touches to each and every aspect of our school life, right from admission to attendance to retention to achievement. But you know, friends, what happens in today's scenario? Though very good practices, policies, very good not practices, very good policies are in place, but what happens at the implementation level when parents of children with disabilities approach the school for admission of their children into the mainstream regular neighborhood school, which claim themselves to be inclusive just because the government has adopted a policy of zero rejection in the admission? These parents are counseled and given special treatment. Now, they have a child with special needs, and the special needs are arising due to disability. And here these parents, when they approach school to seek admission, they are given a special treatment. And what is this special treatment? They are given all kind of counseling, such as what? They are told, देखो जी आपके बच्चे को हम एडमिशन दे देंगे पर यहाँ कोई है नहीं उसका ध्यान देने वाला. And we are saying this for the benefit of your own child, कि अगर हमारा अपना भी बच्चा होता तो भी हम उसे अपने स्कूल में नहीं एडमिशन देते. It's better to get your child admitted to a special school because he will get the desired special treatment there in the special environment with the help of special teachers, special curriculum and special pedagogy practices. यहाँ तक भी सब कुछ ठीक है चलो, बट अगर पेरेंट अड़ी जाए कि नहीं जी मुझे तो आपके स्कूल में ही अपने बच्चे का एडमिशन कराना है, देन द स्पेशल फर्दर स्पेशल ट्रीटमेंट दीज पेरेंट्स आर गिवन इज यू विल हैव टू गिव अस एन अंडरटेकिंग दैट इफ समथिंग हैपन्स टू योर चाइल्ड विद इन द स्कूल ड्यूरेशन देन वी आर नॉट रिस्पॉन्सिबल एज अ स्कूल, और यू हैव टू कम, वन ऑफ द पेरेंट हैड टू कम टू सिट विद द चाइल्ड थ्रू आउट एंड टेक केयर ऑफ द चाइल्ड्स नीड. यू डोंट हैव एनी एक्स्ट्रा रिसोर्सेज फॉर दैट. नाउ व्हेन ऑल दीज कंडीशंस आर पुट इन फ्रंट ऑफ द चिल्ड्रन ऑफ द पेरेंट्स ऑफ चिल्ड्रन विद स्पेशल नीड्स, यू नो वॉट हैपन्स, द पेरेंट्स आर टोटली डिस्करेज, दे आर डिसअपॉइंटेड, दे आर फ्रस्ट्रेटेड. एंड द क्लाइंटेल आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट इज द पेरेंट्स हु अप्रोच आर गवर्नमेंट स्कूल, द स्टेट रन स्कूल. एंड यू नो हु गोज टू दो स्टेट रन स्कूल्स, द पेरेंट्स हु आर डेली लेबरर्स, द पेरेंट्स हु आर वर्किंग डे एंड नाइट टू मीट द डेली एंड्स एंड नीड्स ऑफ देयर चिल्ड्रन एंड फैमिली. वेन दीज पेरेंट्स आर counseled like this, they lose faith in the education system. Now here connect the plight of these parents with you as a parent. How many of us are comfortable talking to our child's teacher during teaching? We may have some hesitation despite being educated, highly educated, working. Most of the time we are at the receiving end from the teachers. Then we go to the PTM of our own children. So think of these poor, maybe illiterate, maybe uneducated parents sitting in against the teacher and the school authorities and listening to all these negativities. Do you think they will be encouraged to seek admission in the school? No. This is one side of the coin. Another side of the coin is, let's assume there is a good school, good school authorities who are welcoming the children with special needs into their folds, and then what happens? Okay, following the zero rejection policy, the children are given, children with disabilities are given admission, they are allowed to share school space, allowed to sit in the classroom. So the next step would be motivating the child and the parents to attend the school regularly. So this is related to practice of attendance. As I said, inclusive education touches all aspects of school life. So first is admission. Yes, you are given admission. Then the child and the parents are motivated and assured that yes, you have to come to the school daily, just like other students who are coming to the school daily, attending the classes daily. And their attendance needs to be such and such, whatever the school norm and state norm says. Now, once the child is coming, sitting in the classroom, this is, as I told earlier, it might be only one dimension of inclusion, that is physical inclusion. Now, we have to include the child in the real sense of the term. So we have to promote educational and functional inclusion also. Now, what is educational and functional inclusion? It is, once the child is sitting in the classroom, I have to adapt my teaching learning modalities. Say, for example, in this Facebook live lecture, if there is some person with hearing impairment, then this audio lecture would be of no use to that person. So for maximum participation or ensuring participation of that person who is not able to hear, I may have to add sign language interpretation to whatever I am saying, or I may have to provide option of live captioning, which converts my spoken words into written words, or I have to speak little slowly with much better lighting that I am in right now, so that the person who is not able to hear is at least able to do the lip reading, or I may have to provide that person a brief of my lecture beforehand. So these are the ways through which I may need to modify my teaching learning practices or the process adopted for this Facebook Live so that that person with hearing impairment is feels included and welcome to this particular lecture on inclusive education. Similarly, in the school sitting settings, when the children with disabilities are sitting in the classrooms, the teachers had to modify their own pedagogy practices. Authorities have to make some modifications in their policies, maybe in their school timetable, maybe in their sitting arrangement, maybe in the infrastructure and resources, so that children with disabilities have a comfortable, joyful school experience. And when the schools become comfortable, joyful, the learning happens. How is this connected to learning? Remember the school experiences that you might have had wherein your teacher ignored you for whatever may be the reason. Did you feel motivated to attend the class of that particular teacher? May not be. So the same thing happens with children with disabilities. Once the child with disabilities or children with disabilities physically included in our school system, they get this message that yes, you are sitting in my classroom, but I'm not going to make any changes in my teaching learning pedagogy. I'm not going to ask you questions. I'm not going to have any expectations from you, whether you submit your schoolwork, homework, classwork, or whatever you do. Or for whatever reasons, these children feel unincluded, they feel unwelcome, and their motivation to learn goes down. So after attendance, retention. The third aspect for inclusive practices is making efforts for their maximum participation and taking responsibility for their learning. Now, who is going to take the responsibility of learning of children with disabilities in the inclusive education setting? It is the regular teachers in collaboration with special education teachers and with the use of lots and lots of resources provided by educational administrators. Now, this is the effort from one side, you can say, that the school authorities are making all these efforts, the school system is making all these efforts, the human resources are optimally utilized, but what about the child with disability? In return, the child with disability has to make his or her best effort. Because now he is being understood, he is being welcomed, he has been respected and valued. So inclusion is a two-way process. It's give and take, kind of a relationship between the education system and the learner, like it happens for the children without disabilities also. So attendance is there, admission is after admission, attendance is there, learning is happening in the way it should happen. Then comes the last, not the last, but another aspect, which is assessment. So once the learning is happening, that's okay. But how do you and I or a third person knows what the child has learned? This we do by assessment. So in an inclusive system, in an inclusive education setting, the assessment modalities also need to be modified. I'll come back to assessment a little later. Now, so far, what we have discussed, we have understood what inclusion is not, what inclusive education and what are the inclusive education practices and how the parents of children with disabilities are discouraged for getting their children admission to the regular mainstream school. Now, these schools, for being inclusive in the true sense, had to work at three levels, and not only the school, the entire education system needs to work at three levels. The inclusive education demands these three levels are macro level, meso level, and the micro level. At the macro level, the government needs to have the right policies, provisions in place so that children with disabilities can be made to feel welcome and included in the mainstream society. As far as Indian government is concerned, we have many laws and legal acts in place, which include RPWD Act and the latest draft education policy 2020, which is being finalized. So in that policy and also in Right to Persons with Disabilities Act, which was passed in 2016 by the Indian Parliament, lot of emphasis has been given for the education of children with disabilities in the mainstream, regular neighborhood school with lot of support services. So at the macro level, our government is acting very proactively. But what is happening at the MISO level? MISO level is the tertiary level or the middle level. Therein, the institutes had to align their policies and practices in line or in harmony with the national level acts and policies. So at the institution level, you may have to do some rearrangement in your infrastructure. You may have to make your infrastructure more inclusive, more barrier friendly. So these kind of things that needs to be done at the institution level, and this is the tertiary, this is the middle level, the second level. And the third is the micro level, which is concerned with what happens in the individual teacher's class at the micro level. How a teacher is adapting the pedagogy practices, how the teaching learning material is made, how the time for extra practice as needed by the child is squeezed out of the entire school day, how the child is made to feel welcome, how the social inclusion is being promoted. So these are the three levels at which we need to work on if we really want our education system to become inclusive. Now friends, I have talked about physical inclusion, wherein the child is asked to sit in the classroom, just merely sitting, maybe like a passive learner. Then we had the educational inclusion, wherein the teachers and the school authorities are doing their level best to include the child participation in all the teaching learning activities and every event that is being done within the school day and school calendar. Then the third aspect is social inclusion. Social inclusion is wherein conscious efforts are made to encourage child's involvement in social aspect of school life, which is concerning making friends, sustaining friendships, not being bullied, not being feeling threatened, and no discrimination. Once we are doing this, then we are taking first step towards making our society inclusive, and this first step needs to start from the school itself. So these are the three aspects of inclusion, and just as we have seen what inclusion is not, so now let's see, after understanding what inclusion is and how inclusion touches the school's practices and policies, let's now understand what inclusion is and what are the characteristics of inclusive education practices. Let's understand the very first practice for inclusive education is it is a never-ending dynamic process. Now, when I'm saying never-ending dynamic process, never-ending is okay, it can go on till anant and till Shashwat times without having an end. But it has to have some self-improving techniques and checks and balances that shows the path towards progress. It's never ending doesn't mean repeating the same practice over and over again. Rather, it means I have inbuilt mechanism to improve my practices for the maximum benefit to the student. This is very first characteristics of inclusive education, that it is not static, it is dynamic, it is never ending, and it is self-improving. So many sub-characteristics within one characteristic. Then we have inclusive second characteristics is it is equity-based. Now, what is equity-based? There are two terms. One is equity and one is equality. Equality is like what we are doing in RMS, ASS, and now in Samagra Shiksha, each child is given teaching learning material from the state. Now, if this teaching learning material is available in the print form, then what will happen? If this teaching learning material is given in the print form, then the child with visual impairment all this teaching learning material may not be of any benefit to this particular child. So with what philosophy this system is operating? Is it operating on equity principle or equality principle? When each person is treated with the same practice, same behavior, then it is based on equality, just like this example wherein child with visual impairment is also given printed books, because we are working on principle of equality. Since each child is given printed books, so this child will also be given printed books, irrespective of taking into account his special need. And when we take into account the special need of each and every child and give provisions accordingly, then we are working on the principle of equity. So equity is taking into account each learner's individual need. So if we work on the principle of equity, we will not give printed books to a child with visual impairment. We will give large font books, braille books, audio books to the child with visual impairment. So this is the difference between equity and equality. So the second characteristics of inclusive education is it is based on the principles of equity. Okay, and the third characteristics of inclusive education is it attempts to address the needs arising due to diversity in human population. And diversity is, as you know, that it's the differences that exist in among individuals, and these differences are seen in our classrooms also. Children come from different regional backgrounds, they come from different religious background, cultural background, social background, economic status, and then they have their own individual differences in terms of their personality characteristics, in terms of their abilities, in terms of their disabilities, in terms of their exposure to textbooks, learning, study habits, and so many other things. So taking into account all these diversities and trying to address the needs arising due to these diversities is another aspect of, is another characteristic of inclusive education. Next characteristic of inclusive education is that it is an effort to make our education system more flexible. Now here, when I'm saying we are making our education system more flexible, that means we are ready to modify each and every practice and aspect of our schooling, higher education, our early system, early education, early literacy, early numeracy also as per the need of the child. So if a child is not able to hear, so along with English or Hindi alphabet or language varnamala, we will try to teach this particular child the finger spellings also, or the sign spelling, sign letters, or initiate the sign language right in the pre-primary. Just like we initiate languages, just like we initiate any other language. Similarly, for children with visual impairment, right from the early classes, we need to have the teaching learning in braille script. So this is another characteristic of inclusive education, that we are trying to attempt to meet or address the individual learning needs of children that is arising due to diversity. And another characteristic of inclusive education after this is we try to remove all kind of barriers. Now, what are the barriers to education? Do we have barriers in education system? Yes, we do. Remember, reading about so many type of characters in our language textbooks, in our social sciences textbooks, in our EVS textbooks, and maybe in other literatures also. So what are the barriers that we face in the within the school, or maybe through curriculum, or maybe through the teacher behavior that is very subjective, or maybe through school policies? You know, the curriculum, let's tackle this very first barrier that is created by curriculum. Remember, all the children or students who are in the states which are neighboring, or which have huge sea shore, studying in the residing in the coastal areas. What happens to these students? Do they find their proper place in our textbooks, in our curriculum? No. I doubt that. And then similarly, if you look at the names in our textbooks, names of the children that we have used as characters, do you see some participation, some representation from the Northeast? There are some nowadays, but earlier it may not have been. So there are many aspects of curriculum which limits learning optimally by our students who are following this curriculum. So these kind of barriers we need to remove. Then we have attitudinal barriers. Do you remember girls were not allowed to study physics maybe 30 years back? Or around 60, 70 years back, nobody would have thought that girls or females could be teachers. And here we are today. The entire profession is dominated by females. So these are the attitudinal barriers. When we say that marginalized need not study, they may come to the school, but they will be involved in the menial work, like cleaning the classroom. Or they are not treated properly, or they are not given midday meal along with other children. So these kind of attitudinal barriers, when you doubt the learner and learner's abilities to learn, this is you are attitudinally excluding the learner from the entire teaching learning process. So inclusive education is all about creating barrier-free environment, and these barriers could be infrastructural, wherein a child with wheelchair, a child using crutches, has to struggle to enter the building through stairs. No, you have to remove this infrastructure barrier. You have to provide ramp. You have to provide accessible toilets. You have to broaden this classroom door so that the wheelchair can move in and out easily. You have to lower the height of the switchboards inside the classroom so that the children having dwarfism. Dwarfism is a condition wherein the height is less than average. They are able to access the switchboards, the water taps, the blackboard easily. So all these infrastructural barriers needs to be removed. This is another characteristic of inclusive education, wherein we show our welcoming gestures through removing all these barriers and barrier-free by providing barrier-free environment. Another aspect of barrier-free environment is, you know, children with visual impairments, we need to have Braille trail for them. And for children with hearing impairment, we have maximum signage in visual mode. And for visually impaired students, we should have signage in audio. Now you can say how it is, how we are going to maintain all these things. Apply universal design for learning approach, wherein all the information is given in multiple formats. So do that, and the barriers would be removed. And if we are following UDL approach, then all attitudinal and infrastructural or any other kind of barriers are automatically removed. We'll talk about UDL in some other lecture. So this is another characteristic of inclusive education, wherein we attempt to remove all kind of barriers to them. Then inclusive education is also about building teams. I agree, it's lot of work for one individual, so we have to build teams, we have to work in collaboration. Regular teacher needs to collaborate with the special educator, special teacher, resource teacher needs to collaborate with the regular teacher, and both needs to share the responsibility of teaching learning of the children with the parents. Then parents may take the help of the counselors, counselors may take the help of the therapist, and all these arms may provide help to the educational administrator. So we need to build teams to effectively implement inclusive education. And these teams should not have any hierarchy. They should not think Oh, I am a medical professional. I am a therapist, so I am much above than the teacher or the special educator or the counselor. No. Educational administrator, the teacher, the special educator, the counselors, the therapists, they all have to come at the same platform, even the parents also. Only then effective implementation of inclusive education can happen at the school level. And inclusive education, since it is education, so how it can be restricted within the four walls of the school? Inclusive education is not restricted, not bound within the four walls of the school. It extends beyond. That means the aspect of inclusion should reflect in all our activities, in all our daily life activities also. Then be it coming to the school and going back home, then be it doing shopping in the marketplace, and it extends to all the social spaces also. And this is how we build the foundation of inclusive society. So inclusive education, the last characteristic is it is the foundation stone of building an inclusive society. So this is what about the characteristics of inclusive education. Now let's see how we reach to this understanding of inclusion, that it is a dynamic process, it is self-improving, it is not limited to the four walls, it is flexible, all these things. Now, how have we reached to this understanding of inclusion? And here I would like to welcome Adya Shakti Rai ji. Adya ji, I've heard a lot about you. Good morning. So, you know what happened in ancient times? How the persons with the disabilities were treated? The persons with disabilities in ancient times were excluded from the mainstream because they were assumed to have some curse, some bad karma, and some curse, some God का कुछ दया नहीं है उन पर, इस तरह का कुछ सोच रहता था, तो उनको मेन स्ट्रीम से हम अलग रखते थे. एंड यू नो यू मस्ट हैव हर्ड अ टर्म कॉल्ड हैंडीकैप, विच इज एसोसिएटेड विद चिल्ड्रन विद और पर्सन विद डिसेबिलिटी. नाउ व्हाई हैंडीकैप? यू नो यू विल बी सरप्राइज टू नो, जस्ट लाइक आई वॉज वेन आई केम टू नो अबाउट दिस फैक्ट, हैंडीकैप इज अ कैप इन द हैंड. दैट मीन्स द पर्सन विद डिसेबिलिटीज वर सपोज टू बी गुड only for begging or collecting alms, and during those times people used to wear hat, and this is also again a very male dominated characteristic, right? कि आपने टोपी पहनी है, आपने अपना टोपी उतारा है और आप उसमें अपनी जो भीख है या भिक्षा है आप वो सब कलेक्ट कर रहे हो. सो दैट इज वाई हैंडीकैप. वी द सोसाइटी एज अ होल इन एंशियंट टाइम डिडंट हैव एनी फेथ इन द एबिलिटी ऑफ पर्सन्स विद डिसेबिलिटीज. दैट इज वाई they were called handicap, cap in hand. So from exclusion, like बिल्कुल ही उनको सोसाइटी से बाहर कहीं रख दिया जाए, से कि ठीक है चलो इनको थोड़ा सा शहर के अंदर भी अगर हैं तो इनको भीख दे करके समाज में थोड़ा सा एकीकृत कर लें. सो दैट इज हैंडीकैप. गुड मॉर्निंग सीमा मैम. सो आफ्टर दिस कैप इन हैंड तक आते आते हमने थोड़ा सा इनके बारे में शायद सोचना शुरू कर दिया था, इसीलिए कुछ एफर्ट्स भी हुए इनको ट्रेन करने के. एंड ऑल दीज एफर्ट्स वर ट्रेन एंड एजुकेशन, एंड ऑल दीज एफर्ट्स वर डन बाय मिशनरीज. सो दे वर कॉल्ड दे वर इंक्लूडेड लिटिल बाय लिटिल थ्रू इंडिविजुअल एफर्ट्स. एंड दिस इज हाउ द स्पेशल एजुकेशन स्टार्टेड, वेयर इन each child taught by an individual, maybe priest or some missionary, some charity organization, some kind-hearted person. So it was one-to-one teaching learning effort, or one mother, one father, all these. So this is how the movement towards special education started, wherein the teacher were using individual effort, the child was making, responding to those individual efforts, the curriculum was individually designed, the pedagogy practices were special. So this is how special education started. Now, in this journey of individual efforts with one or two students, gradually we move to once we have tasted the success with individual effort of individual teacher with individual student, gradually special schools or special schools and teaching in small groups of children with disabilities started. And that too in one disability category setup. Now, when I say one disability category setup, what is that? It is like if I have tasted some success in teaching a child with hearing impairment, so now I try teaching four other children with hearing impairment together. So it was a small setting, special schools having one kind of disability. Gradually, these initial special educators, I'm calling them, so they were all missionaries and all individual parents or something, some organizations. All these initial special educators, they gradually started experimenting with multi-category setups. So, okay, I'm doing some experimenting with teaching with children with visual impairment. Let me take some children with other disabilities also into account. And gradually, these multi-category special schools setup was organized. And pre-independence era, India had a number of special schools set up by these missionaries. So that was the beginning of teaching learning of children with special needs in a formalized setup. But these schools, these educational settings were still cut away from the mainstream education and curriculum. They were following the special education, they were following the special pedagogy principles, practices, they were following the special curriculum, and they may or may not be teaching these children for career or vocation or for independent living. The thought still was कि इनको ठीक है थोड़ा पढ़ा देते हैं पर इनमें शायद इतनी एबिलिटी नहीं है कि ये इंडिपेंडेंटली अपनी जीविका अर्जन कर लेंगे और रह लेंगे. सो इट वॉज लाइक ऑल चैरिटी बेस्ड. हम अभी भी सिर्फ दया भाव से काम कर रहे थे विद लिटिल और नो फेथ इन द एबिलिटीज डिस्पाइट दिस चिल्ड्रन प्रूविंग सक्सेसफुल बाई इंडिविजुअल एफर्ट. दिस इज हाउ वी रीच टू दी स्पेशल एजुकेशन सेटिंग. Now, from this special education setting, some enthusiastic special educators experimented with integrating special children with the mainstream schools. The thought could have been behind their experimentation might be that they have to live into the society. They have to live in the society after schooling, or they are part of the society. So what they need to do is, so they thought, let us try integrating children with disabilities with children without disabilities in the same school. But now they were approaching very cautiously. So they had the school space divided into regular and special. So there was a rigid physical boundary within the same school building. So it was like having two setups in the same building, one for dedicated for special children and one dedicated for regular children without disability, right? So up in this setting, now you may say, what was the use of it? The thought might have been behind this practice was the children will be in each other's vicinity, so they may get unplanned chance to interact with each other, which may or may not have happened. It was all a chance taken by the followers of those initial integrated education experimenters. Now, the experiences of this integrated education led to the mainstream. Once the educators have seen that when children are in the same building, both type of children, children with disabilities and children without disabilities are in the same building, but they may or may not be interacting with each other, And whatever little interaction are happening between the two population, they are proving beneficial for each. Maybe they might have realized that. So they thought of experimenting with conscious opportunities of interaction between the two school-going population, attending the school within the same building or maybe with a little distance. And we reached the practice called mainstream, wherein the practitioners thought, now this group of children, they seem ready to interact with children without disabilities. So let's try to mainstream them in the regular school, wherein they spend some time with the children without disabilities, maybe morning assembly time, or maybe language time, or maybe a little art or craft time. And the rest of the time, they are into their own special school. So this is the practice of mainstream. Now, before coming to inclusion, Rainu Gupta ji is asking whether a teacher should know the pedagogy to be used in such classes. Yes, in the today's context, each teacher teaching in the classroom needs to be an inclusive education teacher. Why inclusive education teacher? Because there are children with diverse background, diverse abilities sitting in front of us. So we need to know our children first, need to have a good rapport with them, need to understand what kind of learner they are. So we need to know the learner and change our pedagogy practices. And inclusive pedagogy practices are nothing rocket science. They are minor modifications in our day-to-day teaching learning practices so that jo aap kehna chahe wo us bacche tak pahunch jaye aur usi tarah se pahunche jaise wo seekhna chahta hai. Raini Gupta is again asking, ki, are they doing practices while doing B.Ed. and D.L.Ed. etc.? NCTE is in the process of revising the B.Ed. teacher training courses and all. And few activists have recommended that yes, the practice teaching should be done in the inclusive education setting. So before taking some more questions, let me come back to the journey of inclusion. From we started with exclusion, then we reached to integrated education settings, then we came to the mainstreaming, and then now inclusion. The little bit success in the mainstreaming schools that we have achieved might have led to the thinking of inclusion, wherein we accept the child as it is with his or her entire skill set, abilities, differences, diversities. We accept them, we respect them, we value them. We say it's a mutual process. You change a little, I change a little as a school system, and together we will achieve the success. This is inclusion. Inclusion doesn't demand that if you know the braille, if you are able to take audio notes, if you know the sign language, only then you will be included. No. Inclusion says you come to the school, and if you do not know the sign language, we'll try to arrange an interpreter. We'll try to arrange a sign language teacher. This is what the principle on which our Samagra Shiksha, SSA and RMSA has been working on. And the school system tries to provide the therapeutic services. And nowadays, in many of the states, somewhere the children with special needs are given short leaves in school. Short leaves for students might be a radical concept. You know, when you want to do some important work, you apply for short leave in office and school as a working professional, that we need half day leave or we need 2 hours leave. But such kind of leave make them available for students so that they attend their therapy session, which might be a duration of 40 minutes to 1 hour to 1 hour 15 minutes. And instead of taking the whole day absence from the regular school, they are allowed to leave the school for short duration, attend their therapy session, and come back and attend the regular class. This provision many state schools are doing. And another alternative to this could be arranging the therapy services within the school campus or nearby in the cluster mode. So that can also be thought of. There are lot many things that we need to do in our inclusive education setting. That is why it is a dynamic process. It is not a one-time activity, and it is a collaborative effort. So this was about how we arrived at inclusion starting from exclusion, special education, integration, and mainstream. So we are right now in the process of inclusion. And in many places, reverse inclusion is also happening. Surprise? What is reverse inclusion? Reverse inclusion is wherein children without disabilities are attending special schools. Why? Because special schools, the pupil-teacher ratio is very less. Though I have seen this experimentation in hardly 10 or 11 schools across country. So it's, let's see how it's going to show its results. But this is also happening. So this is all about journey from special to inclusive education. And now, who are the beneficiaries of this inclusive education practices? The very first name that might have come to you is children with disabilities. Yes, children with disabilities are definitely beneficiaries of inclusive education system. And after RPWD Act 2016, we recognize 21 categories of children with disability. 21 categories. It's huge. And within each disability category, there exists a lot of variation. And these categories include disabilities which can be easily identified through vision, visuals. By seeing the child, you can say that, yes, this child is not like others. It may have some special needs. And then there are disability conditions which are invisible, meaning the child with disability appears just like any other child without disabilities, and it's difficult to identify that this child may have some disability or some challenging condition. So these conditions are like learning disabilities, autism, and maybe children coming from disadvantaged sections also. So all these are the conditions wherein the symptoms cannot be seen through the naked eye and just the eye, and we need specialized treatment, specialized precision to identify their special needs. So these are called invisible conditions. So children with disabilities, both type of conditions, and all 21 disability categories, they are beneficiaries of inclusive education practices. Then we have another beneficiaries are children who are coming from disadvantaged sections or communities or disadvantaged part of the society. They are the marginalized. We may keep them in the scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, minority, and educationally backward communities, the unreached, the children belonging to the section of the society which are affected by natural calamities or by human actions like industrialization or the terrorist activities or other kind of activities which grossly affect the life of the children. They are also beneficiaries of inclusive education. And third beneficiary of inclusive education is, can you think of the category? Children with disabilities we have covered, children with disadvantaged section we have covered. The third category would be the children without disabilities. Is that right? Yes. Children without disabilities are also the beneficiaries of inclusive education. How? You know, each child with or without disability has his or her unique style of learning, and this style of learning may be visual learner, maybe auditory learner, maybe kinesthetic learner, maybe spatial learner, maybe interpersonal learner, maybe interpersonal learner. So each child has their unique style. So when they have this unique style of teaching learning, and they may take in information through audio mode, or they may prefer taking in information through visual mode, and once you are following inclusive pedagogy practices, you are following universal design for learning, wherein multiple mode of expression, information giving and receiving is followed. So each child in the classroom benefits. Inclusive education practices are nothing but good practices of teaching learning, and good practices of teaching learning benefit each and every child. Okay, so Sonali Jaiswal is saying that there are so many children in the classroom, and if teacher is giving so much importance to only 3-4 students, the rest of the students will feel ignored. If rest of the students are feeling ignored, that means you are not following inclusive education practices. Inclusive education practices says if a child cannot speak, then for yes, if that child is using this, and for no, this that child is using this, thumbs down, then the entire class should use this. Otherwise, this child will feel alienated. This child will feel excluded. So friends, we have reached the beneficiaries of inclusive education and covered rationale behind inclusive education, ki hame kyon chahiye inclusive education, it has so many benefits, it has so many characteristics. And Rainu ji is asking now how the teacher will control the class. The teacher will definitely, now we have to make some changes in our thinking. It is all about attitude. Our classrooms need to be democratic, and in democratic classrooms there is no control. The teacher is a facilitator, so there is no question of controlling the class. It could be classroom management. Engage the children positively, establish classroom rules through discussion, and then the classrooms will be inclusive. You remember, even as a young child we know what is good for us and what is bad. Experience has taught us. So trust the abilities of our children. And instead of controlling, try to be a learner with them. The last part of this lecture is, the second last part is principles or assumptions about inclusive education. Let me quickly read out these assumptions. These are given by UNESCO and universally accepted by all the countries. This includes inclusion is a dynamic process, it is not a static process. It is facilitation of first identification of barriers and then facilitation of removal of these barriers. Second principle. Third principle is inclusion maximizes participation of all learners in the process of teaching learning. And fourth is lot of support is provided to the functionaries of inclusive education. So these are the four guiding principles of inclusive education. Now let's come to the last part, which is United Nations Convention on the Right of Persons with Disabilities. Now this convention was passed in 2006 and India was one of the country who has ratified this convention. And you may not be knowing that the principles of UNCRPD is adopted in letter and sense by the Right to Persons with Disabilities Act passed by our parliament in 2016. So our entire RPWD Act is based on the principles of United Nations Convention on Right of Persons with Disabilities. And just like the principles of inclusive education adopted by UNESCO, the four principles, these are similar on the similar lines, which ensures and guides all the policies, practices and cultures which needs to be followed in the inclusive education setting. The very first of this is respect for inherent dignity, individual autonomy of each and every person and child, irrespective of their status, ability and disability. Respect their choice of independent decision making. You may counsel them. You may provide them facts and figures. You may give them the pros and cons of their decision, but respect the choice of making decisions for their life. This is the very first principle of UNCRPD. Second principle is non-discrimination. You cannot discriminate between the child on the basis of disability or any person. Since we are talking about Disability Act, so it's about disability, with the basis of disability, you cannot discriminate between a person that yes, he should be involved in this and he should not be involved in this. Lay the facts on table, let the person decide, but you need not discriminate. This is the second principle. Third principle is full and effective participation in each and aspect of the society. You can't say that we have made our educational institutions barrier-free, we have made our educational institutions participatory, inclusive. So that's all. No. But children with disabilities, persons with disabilities have the right to be included in all aspects of social life. How many of you have noticed persons with wheelchair, persons using wheelchair riding in the local conveyance, state-run buses, trains? May not be. Because our buses and trains are not inclusive. They may not have space. In Delhi, metros have space for wheelchair. But still, we do not see many wheelchair users using this facility because only metro is wheelchair accessible. What about the place where they have to get down and they have to visit, maybe malls or something? So this is the third principle. Full and effective participation and inclusion in the society. This is the third principle for UN, which is advocated by UNCRPD. Then UNCRPD says that respect for individual differences, accept the person as it is, and trust in their abilities, they are part and parcel of human diversity. You cannot ignore them. Fifth principle is equality of opportunity. Now here, UNCRPD is advocating equality of opportunity. So the thought might be, let's have the equal opportunity. Let's give them opportunity to come to the equal platform. Then we may think of giving equity-based provision. Then sixth principle is accessibility. Like I talked about the metro being accessible, but may not be the shopping malls or the hospitals. And one of the anecdotes shared by somebody during one workshop was, in a hospital facility for children with visual, persons with visual impairment, yani ki hospital ka wo special wing jahan par aankhon ka ilaaj kiya jata hai aur jahan par mostly visually impaired log jaate hain, wahan par jo bhi information thi wo visual mode mein display ki ja rahi. This kind of inclusion is not accepted at all. This is not accessible at all. आपको पता है वो स्पेशल फैसिलिटी है जहाँ पे विजुअली इम्पेयर्ड लोग जाएंगे, तो व्हाई नॉट टू गिव इन्फॉर्मेशन इन द ऑडियो फॉर्मेट और इन द ग्रीन फॉर्म. बट दैट वाज नॉट हैपनिंग. सो दिस इज सुपरफिशियल स्यूडो काइंड ऑफ इंक्लूजन व्हिच इज नॉट एट ऑल एक्सेप्टेबल. दैट इज व्हाई यूएनसीआरपीडी वेरी फोर्सफुली हैज सेड एक्सेसिबिलिटी एज वन ऑफ इट्स प्रिंसिपल. देन टॉकिंग अबाउट इंडिया, अ नेशन ऑब्सेस्ड विद मेल चाइल्ड, that a reality which still prevails, however hard we may try to hide it beneath the carpet. More prevalent might be in rural areas, low SES, but still a reality. So UNCRPD has advocated equality between men and women. Girls with disabilities are given equal status with men with disabilities. You might have heard many times parents and relatives saying, ek to ladki hai upar se apahij hai, ek to ladki hai upar se dekh nahi sakti. So what does it mean? Being female and if you have a disability, you are doubly or triply disadvantaged. Once, just because you are a girl. Second, because you are a disabled. Third, because you belong to that particular section of the society. So UNCRPD, realizing this, said men and female with disabilities need to be treated at par. They have equal rights. And the last principle of UNCRPD is have faith in the evolving capabilities and abilities of children with disabilities. You just have to have faith. जैसे आपको पता है एक छोटा बच्चा, उसकी कैपेबिलिटीज धीरे धीरे, लैंग्वेज, मैथमेटिकल, लॉजिकल, रीजनिंग, थिएट्रिकल, म्यूजिक, डांस, ऑल दीज कैपेबिलिटीज दे इवॉल्व, दे ग्रो. सिमिलरली चिल्ड्रन विद डिसेबिलिटीज हैव देयर इंडिविजुअल इननेट स्ट्रेंथ. वी हैव टू हैव पेशेंस, फेथ टू लेट दिस स्ट्रेंथ लॉस. सो फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज ऑल दैट आई हैड टू शेयर विद यू टूडे about inclusive education. Now if you have some questions, I'll be happy to take all the questions. Rainu ji was asking so many questions. So another question from Rainu Gupta. She's saying teacher should have the knowledge of sign language also. Rainu ji, you know, children with disabilities, how they are discriminated from our mainstream society. There are four aspects, four dimensions through which they are being discriminated. Number one is ableism. What is ableism? If you look around yourself, the entire environment is designed for persons who are able-bodied. So, chahe wo aapki stairs ho, chahe wo aapke doors ho, chahe wo aapki lifts ho. Lifts mein, nowadays we find braille script denoting the number of floor that you want to go into. And trains have also recently started writing berth numbers or seat numbers in braille. Earlier it was not there. So accessibility is increasing, but still a lot needs to be done, and whatever we have designed it for able body. So ableism is one dimension through which persons with disabilities are discriminated. Second is surdophobia. Surdophobia is phobia of persons who cannot hear sound. Basically, we are discriminating against persons who are not able to hear. And similar to this is autism, wherein again, there is a discrimination against persons who are not able to hear. And then another dimension is design apathy. Again, everything is supporting the ability, not the disability. So in this scenario, wherein persons with disabilities are facing lot of discrimination, and now there is a teacher who is asking me a question that as a teacher, do I need to know sign language? My answer to this would be, if you want to communicate to the child or to a person with hearing impairment, if the other person with whom you want to communicate not able to hear you, so how are you going to communicate with that person? You have to modify your way of giving information. Either use flashcards with main points written on that, or learn everyday greeting words in sign language, or use ICT, use live captioning. There are a lot of ways available. So there is no need to rely only on sign language, but sign language is very interesting, let me tell you. I have also learned few words in sign language. Say, for example, thank you is this. Jump is this. Cat is this. It's not difficult. So Rainu ji is saying, theoretically everything is there, but what about yes? Implication, I completely agree, needs to improve a lot. But let me share my experience with you. After working for more than 15 years in this area, now at least I don't have to start with making target audience understand what special needs is. We have reached a point wherein nowadays people understand, yes, people with special needs exist, and who are these people? A little bit awareness is coming. That is how we have Accessible India campaign led by ARCOM. That means some windows have opened in the rigid boundary. And these windows, these small windows or openings that we have created, needs to now multiply by leaps and bounds. And this is going to happen. Lot of emphasis has been given on the inclusivity, accessibility, flexibility in our draft National Education Policy 2020. So the coming times are very hopeful, and let's see the implementation occurring at the field level with open mind, with lot of flexibility, with lot of innovation. Inclusion is an area which requires daily new innovation and experimentation. It's a practice wherein you can't prescribe single pill to each and every patient showing similar symptoms. You have to customize the treatment. So I hope this answers your question, Rainuji. Any other question or any other thing, point, observation that you want to share on this? Meanwhile, you think of your questions and all. There are many dimensions, hidden dimensions in our school system, which promote exclusion. There are many, many examples out there. And if you think sensitively, you'll realize our curriculum, our pedagogy practices, the way we make our children sit in the classroom, the way we disperse them, the way we distribute midday meal, the way we organize picnics, the way we organize excursions. Within each of these, there are huge opportunities of both exclusion and inclusion, and maximum time which consciously, unconsciously, due to our own prevailing attitudes, beliefs, and stereotypical thinking. Because after all, we are also part of the society which is prevailing all these myths and attitudes. We end up discriminating between children. Recently, I visited an inclusive school in rural India, wherein twin brothers in early primary were studying and attending the regular schools, and they both the children were not able to hear. They were hearing impaired. Their teachers very enthusiastically showed me their behavior, that it was around the midday meal distribution time, and the elder brother went a little ahead and the younger brother picked up a stone and threw it. The teacher said, "Ma'am, देखो ये कितना aggressive है." I said, "आप बताओ मुझे, वो बड़ा भाई आगे चला गया, तो अब ये इसको बुलाना है उसे, वो भी नहीं सुन सकता और ये भी नहीं सुन सकता, तो वो उसकी अटेंशन कैसे गेन करेगा?" The teacher said, "Yes, we have never thought about it." Inclusive education practices only require sensitivity towards me. We just need to be sensitive about how and when to communicate. What modalities of communication expressions are needed to engage these children in the activity, enhance their participation. And not only, this is not only concerned about how we take in information, this is also concerning about how we elicit information from them. If they are not able to speak, then are we sensitive enough to give them opportunities to express themselves through any other mode, say collage, if you are talking about home assignment, or through gestures, or through maybe taking your, holding your hand and dragging you to the scene the child wanted to show? As a teacher, we have to be open to all these opportunities. And of course, there is ICT nowadays to make our lives much simpler, much easier. This is how we are able to connect to each other, being even after being located at geographically different locations. So I believe in this group, whoever is watching, only Rainuji is so active, asking so many questions. और आपको पता है, हमारी सोसाइटी में नाउ डेज स्टिल वी हैव अ सेक्शन विच इज डिवॉइड ऑफ एजुकेशनल अपॉर्चुनिटी, जस्ट बिकॉज दे लिव इन ज्योग्राफिकली डिफिकल्ट, वेरी डिफिकल्ट लोकेशन वेयर द स्कूल्स कैन नॉट बी ओपन और कैन नॉट बी मेड एक्सेसिबल. So, friends, I hope this is all about today's topic on inclusive education. So, shall we end this live lecture now? So, Muji, I need your input on this. I hope I have not missed any question. Okay, so thank you, friends. Thank you for patience, very patient listening. Now, Pavan Kumar ji. Okay, he's simply introducing himself. Dinesh Kumar ji, I have already touched about equality and equity. Yes, very rightly, when we work on accommodating individual needs and make changes in the provisions as per the individual need of the child, we are working on equity principle. So this is it. Thank you, friends. See you soon in next lecture, as and when I get the opportunity. So thank you.